Thanks for tuning in to our podcast series, Scaling Without Borders. As a pan-European PR agency, we've supported many companies in their journey to expand to other markets. In this series, we take a deep dive into how scale-ups can grow their business beyond their home country. We'll shed a light on this challenge from different perspectives. Entrepreneurs who have already successfully done this, the investor community funding these ambitious people, and the startup ecosystem supporting them. This first season, we focus on the Dutch scale-up community. What are their insights on how to scale abroad successfully? All to inspire other entrepreneurs to perhaps do the same.
Hello, and welcome to this episode of Scaling Without Borders. In this series, we interview some of Europe's leading experts in the startup community to learn from their experience and understand their vision on how to successfully grow a startup or scale up across borders. In today's episode, we're joined by Matt Welle. Matt is the CEO of Mews, a European cloud-based software company that provides property management products and services to 5,500 organizations in the hospitality industry. Matt and Mews founder Richard have created a true rocket ship that has been growing at a rapid pace and that just has raised its seventh round of funding and completed 9 acquisitions to date. A true expert in scaling without borders. I'm Chantal, and I'm a senior partner at Tyto. And I'm joined by Erik, who's a senior partner as well.
Hi, and welcome to the Scaling Without Borders podcast, Matthijs.
Thank you for having me.
So to start, Mews has expanded successfully to a range of countries. What were the factors that led you to decide it was the right time to expand internationally?
It wasn't very scientific, I can tell you. We started the company in Czech Republic, which is a very small country similar to the Netherlands, a little bit smaller actually than the Netherlands. And very quickly we realized we're going to run out of runway in that territory in terms of total addressable market. So we found that in Eastern Europe, salaries are much lower. And we found that the automation that we brought wasn't appreciated as much because it was sometimes cheaper to just deploy humans than computers. So we struggled with go-to-market. So we very quickly realized we're going to have to go west into Western European territories where cloud systems saw stronger adoption. And also just Czech Republic just isn't big enough. And I think you'll see that with a lot of Dutch entrepreneurs, for example, as well. If you're in the Netherlands and scaling, that's exciting, but you're going to run out of runway at some point. So it's better to start planning architecturally from a system point of view to scale internationally, but also putting feet on the ground in different territories much earlier than you probably want to. Because for us, we didn't want to. We were just forced to. We didn't have money to just suddenly start deploying people in different countries. But we just, if we wanted to build a global business, we thought better start early than too late.
It almost sounds easy, but I'm sure you have experienced some barriers or challenges in your international expansion. Can you say something about that?
Yeah, I remember, especially in the early days, when you don't have entities in different countries and there weren't companies like remote.com, that can help you employ employees in different countries legally. So we struggled because we're like, well, we need people on the ground in France. We need them in the UK, in the Netherlands, in Spain. And then you can't just employ them like you would in a different state in America. It's much easier than it is in Europe. You are very much bound by different countries. And whilst we are part of the EU, it is a very mixed bag of what you're going to get. And the EU definitely doesn't help startups like us to succeed and compete with American companies because you're stuck with employment law, all of the local laws. We do travel, so you've got all the different taxes, all the fiscal integrations that have to be processing bills for hotels. And it is honestly one of the most painful parts of expanding the business. And it is one of the least sexy things to have to deal with. Like, I just want to build a great technology and have an unlimited total addressable market, which could be the whole of Europe. But unfortunately, every single border you cross, you're going to have to localize, speak a different language. And that makes it really hard for us as Europeans to compete with American companies that can just infinitely scale within one country, one legislation kind of framework. And I think that's one of the reasons why you don't see huge amounts of European companies IPO or go public and list.
Thanks, that's very insightful. So you just talked about how you expanded from the Czech Republic and also I believe also one of the factors, like looking at other countries you want to expand to, was maybe the rate of cloud adoption, right? To see which market could be ready for a solution like yours. Were there other factors that helped you in prioritizing which markets to enter? Like I could imagine like maybe the tourism industry, the hospitality industry might be bigger in Southern Europe. So how did you prioritize?
Yeah, so because we're a SaaS company, but we also do fintech. So half our revenue actually comes from payments. So we very much focus on city dense locations with high occupancies in hotels, meaning we process more payments through the books. So it's always been very city center focused, but also Western Europe, where average rates in hotels are much higher. And also we find that fintech adoption is just stronger in Northern and Western Europe than it is in South Europe, where you still have to convince them that, you know, people will want to pay with modern payment types. Germany, for example, has been a really tough market for us to break into because cash was still king there for many years. And COVID was definitely an accelerator for Germany, but we've been there for about a decade. And only about last year did we start to see real widespread adoption of our solution in that market. But it took us 10 years of saying, you know, Apple Pay is like, it's a real thing and we can move cash into complete automation on the payment side. And it really very much depends per market, you know, whether they embraced technology like the cloud solutions before. And if you like, the Netherlands was our first market where we really started scaling, because this is probably one of the most ready markets to adopt the cloud versus some of the Southern European countries that you mentioned, where we've just seen some hurdles. We've got lots of legacy vendors that we're up against. And the inertia is real in some of the territories where customers are like, I'm quite happy with my on-prem and I've had it for 20 years. It's kind of not broken, so I don't really need to change it. And we're like, no, it's broken. You just don't realize it. And it's this constant battle against inertia being our biggest competitor today. Like, we've got lovely competitors in the market, but inertia by far is our biggest competitor. Whereas we didn't feel that here in the Netherlands as much, or the Nordics, for example. In the Netherlands now, 1 in 3 bedrooms runs on Mews in hotels, which is very different in Southern Europe, because we've just found that inertia to be real.
Okay, thanks for elaborating on that. So you just mentioned specifically the German market, but I also read, I think on LinkedIn, you mentioned that the entrance of Mews in the French market was everything but smooth. So it's currently your number one market, I believe, worldwide.
Yeah, so in France, we do about 1 in 10 bedrooms in France now runs on Mews. So it's larger than the Netherlands. That just gives you a sense of the size of the French hotel market.
Okay, so could you maybe elaborate a bit on the specific hurdles you had in entering that market?
Yeah, the French are very vocal in their feedback, which in the beginning, our system wasn't great. Like, when we started building our solution, it just really wasn't great. And we struggled specifically on the accounting side a lot. And we got some very vocal feedback from the French market, which took us a while to get some customers to truly adopt the system and find fans, because the French are either very strong, negatively opinionated, but when you win them over and you have their hearts, they are the best advertisers for your business, like the best lighthouse accounts. And it took us a number of years to get these unhappy customers into very happy customers. And now we love it in France, because they just, you know, sing our praises from the rooftops. Another real big challenge that we found in France is that when you're a cash register system, which, because we process revenue for the hotel and we issue bills, we'd be classified as a cash register system. So you have to be compliant with local legislation, which was written for on-premise systems. They released this a couple of years ago, but the legislation that's in place was not actually written for cloud systems. So it's really hard for a cloud system to lock in their code and give that on a cassette to the legislator. We figured this out, but it took us a huge amount of development and legislation hoops to jump through. So whilst we now love it, because we're now certified and we're officially a vendor allowed to sell in that market, the threshold to entry for new competitors is very high. And we see that some competitors have left that market because of this, which, you know, for us it's now great, but it's a pity, because I love straight great competitors that make us work harder for, you know, pushing our product to the next level.
So you still have some competitors left then?
Oh yeah. Sadly, yes. Hundreds, actually. It's crazy fragmented.
All right. So you've done quite some acquisitions, 9, I believe, to date. Have these been mainly driven by a strategy to accelerate revenue growth, or were they about adding technology or services, or was it simply to add or enter a new market?
It's all of it, honestly. So it's a mix. So we very early started. We started after our Series B with our first acquisition, which feels very early for any company to start doing acquisitions at the pace that we're doing now. But we thought, we saw the fragmentation that was out there. Like you asked about competitors, there's literally hundreds of competitors. Every country has 5 to 10 local flavor PMSs. And the inertia that I talked about earlier as well is real. Like hotels are like, it's not broken. And we're like, no, it is broken. But to dislodge that inertia, it takes either a lot of marketing, or we buy these customers and we basically saying, you know, you're going to have to migrate in the next 2 years because we will sunset this product. And that gentle push has actually helped dislodge some of this inertia that we see. So 7 of those acquisitions were a legacy buy. We just bought a legacy competitor and we convert customers to us within like a 2-year time span. And then we add the fintech on top, and that model works really, really well. But also because we're the central technology solution for hotels, we integrate with everything. We've got 1,000 integrations in our marketplace. We're the most integrated hospitality solution today. So we see exactly in a marketplace what works really well and what doesn't, and which are the most popular in each category. So it's almost a playbook, like, okay, which category should go after? Because here you can make a lot of SaaS revenue or fintech revenue. And then we start those conversations. So we've done 2 of those acquisitions. We will announce 2 more this year, if not 3, that we're currently working on, which is on the product side and on the legacy buy side, but also on market expansion. So last year we did a legacy buy in Canada. We had never sold an organic contract ever until we did this acquisition. And obviously now these customers start migrating, but we see this organic lift coming because there's a brand proliferation in the market. Suddenly we're everywhere. We're loud, you know, we're known for our loud branding. We have opinions about everything. And the Canadians had never heard of us, but suddenly there's hundreds of hotels that are now starting to migrate to Mews. And then the neighbors see, hey, this hotel's on this great cloud system. Maybe I should have a look at their website. And we started seeing this organic lift from the inorganic journey that we have. So it definitely has multiple angles.
Right. And well, besides a growing number of clients, of course, you have a growing number of employees as well, both with organic growth and due to the acquisitions. I know you're a strong ambassador of a solid company culture. And how do you maintain this culture you have envisioned? And how does it work with growing your company?
Yeah, it is hard because we've leaned into remote first. So I don't believe in the Amazon model of forcing people 5 days back into an office. And I also don't believe in the hybrid model anymore. I think hybrid is the worst of both worlds, where you're not really set out to support those people that work in remote, but you're also not really set up to do everything in person. And we leaned into saying, we're going to be remote first. We think that this is the future that everyone wants to work in, like employees at least, and you should treat employees as adults, and you hire adults and then treat them as adults. And we've leaned into that, which is a massive shift for us because we used to be all in offices, and we're learning. I think there's definitely a lot of lessons we're taking, because if you're alone, home alone, you don't really make friends easily on a conference call. So we invest a lot in offsite. So I save on office costs, but I fly people in for offsite at least 3 times a year so that we can spend time in a room, but with purpose. So I love a water cooler conversation, but they don't often add real value. I'd rather put you in a room with colleagues and give you a mission, like talk about this topic because I think it's really relevant. So we think very much about the why behind our business and making sure that we can get people engaged with the culture. And an engaged team will produce, what, 20% more, I think I've read recently, in productivity outputs because they're really engaged on the mission. And that's really the goal. And I'm, you know, my day is very much less about product and about finances. It's much more about building culture and driving the culture, because I have hired people that will drive the outcomes of the business, but I'm a culture tastemaker as a CEO nowadays.
Thanks, Matt. Well, looks like we have a lot in common. Tyto's fully remote as well. So
great. Well done.
We understand your vision on that one. So just wanted to talk a bit about fundraising. So you've already raised a significant amount, like 440 million, I believe, funding in the past years. So how did you approach fundraising? What strategies actually helped you secure, for instance, the latest round of funding?
So the first time it was so bad. Like, it's honestly, we had no idea. We just two guys that were just starting a business in a basement in Prague. And I remember our first pitches, they were awful. And I still have the decks because I often use them as saying, okay, this was the first deck and this is how we now position it. Because now I'm very clear on what that story is. And I can pitch that in 10 minutes or I can pitch it in 40 minutes. And I've got a set of decks that I have always on the ready, because tomorrow I'm flying into Stockholm to talk to investors. And that pitch, like through a decade of pitching, has got a lot better to, you know, talking about, okay, how big is the market? What's the problem? Why are we the ones to solve the problem? What's the solution? And how are we going to go forward? And that storyline, you get really good at. But it is a 10,000 hour rule, kind of. You've got to do this so many times and so many failures to go through before you get good at it. Recently, obviously, we've professionalized a lot of our finance teams. And like that last raise, I haven't personally been involved as much as I used to. We used to do everything ourselves. Richard and myself would go and pitch. We would do the due diligence. And as you professionalize, you just hire phenomenal team members below you that can help drive this. The latest fundraise was a 100 million raise that we did, which is a debt round, actually. So sometimes you do equity rounds and sometimes you do debt rounds. And the debt rounds, we use debt very much for the acquisitions strategy, where we buy profitable, successful businesses that we bring in. And it's much easier to get debt for those types of acquisitions. And really, it's to accelerate our growth. We're seeing such an opportunity. It's a strange thing at the moment because the markets are still struggling and tech companies have struggled for a couple of years now post-COVID. We're seeing the opposite trend because hospitality has just reopened and we're seeing this real push from on-prem into the cloud. So it feels very counterintuitive for us to raise more money and spend more money when everyone else is trying to get to efficiency. And we're like, no, we're leaning into growth because the opportunity is so great. And our underlying metrics of the business are so strong that we should be growing faster and faster. And that's really the why investors are so excited about the business.
I can imagine. So you just said, well, the latest investment will be mostly leveraged for new acquisitions. Can you share with us maybe what regions you're thinking about? What countries?
So they definitely fit. We try and focus on regions we're already in because it means it's just an acceleration of go-to-market, because every time you open a new region, it's a distraction from the core focus. So if it's a legacy buy, it will be in a territory that we already operate in today so that we just accelerate go-to-markets. But I think a lot of the focus has been on product acquisitions, like how do we round out the portfolio? Because as a company the size that we are, you start to think about, okay, 3-4 years ahead, what are the options? And we'd love to go towards an IPO. That's one of the outcomes of the business, if we want to run it ourselves. So we're thinking, okay, if you want to get to IPO, one of the main metrics that you have to drive is net revenue retention. So showing that from your existing customers, you drive significantly more growth in revenue over time. And this is the one metric that we're good at. Our net revenue retention is 125, but it's coming mostly from expanding within customer portfolio. So we're adding hotels within the brand, for example, but we'd love to upsell as well because they still buy 7 integrations. So why aren't we the supplier of those integrations? And that's why we're doing a lot on the product side right now to round out our ecosystem.
All right, so what are the key milestones for the next few years and how do you plan to achieve those?
Like, it's a mix. So it's definitely the US is a big factor. If we were to IPO at some point in the future, it's most likely to be the US IPO. European stock exchanges don't really understand the type of business that we are in a vertical with SaaS and with fintech. So it's likely to be US. That means that we have to grow faster in the US than anywhere else to show that we've got real consistency of our business in that particular market. Another angle is really rounding out that ecosystem to really have a fully fledged solution that we can sell to customers as an end-to-end solution. So that's another thing. And if I look at Europe, obviously, we want to really make sure that we've got real a land grab that we do here, because whilst in the Netherlands and the Nordics, we're hitting 30-40% of the market, I'd like to get that in Germany and France and the UK, because those are major markets for us. So we are doubling down on success stories that we're having in those markets and making sure that we get a real density of rollouts in those markets. And then lastly, on the product side, we've been diversifying our platform from what is expected of a typical, where the category is called property management system. But we think we can do so much more for a hotel because we're in the fintech flow. So we could help diversify the fintech offering for a hotel. So for example, we can do lending, for example. Hotels are pretty cash poor. So if you need a loan, great. You can have money in your bank tomorrow. If you use Mews, for example, we can help them with dynamic currency conversion. Over time, we could look at doing things like payroll. So there's a lot of work that we're doing on the product side, how we can diversify the fintech solutions, but also on the SaaS side, diversify beyond hotels into other categories. Like apart hotels is a category that supports hybrid travelers, where you just want to rent a room for a month or 2 months, but traditional systems don't support that. And we love it. That's exactly our model. So as I'm listening to what myself talking, there's no lack of ambition. There's definitely a thing that we need to focus on more. Like we have to say focus, 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 and say no more. And we're not great at saying no. That's the thing I'd like to improve in the next 2 years.
Oh, thanks for that insight. It has been a very insightful conversation already. To close off, to round up, what has been your biggest learning or surprise maybe during the whole scaling process? And what would your advice be to other entrepreneurs with international ambitions?
I'd say the biggest learning has been to just go do it early. Don't wait until you've got real traction in one market. Start to plant those seeds as early as possible. And like, I'm a innately conservative kind of founder in terms of placing bets, but I balance out through a co-founder who's actually pushing the limits of it. And I think you need to really understand yourself and find someone to support you who's extremely different from you, that you have a really strong relationship with, that can balance you. Because I think doing a journey like this all alone is really, really hard. And I've had so much support by having a co-founder, but also making sure that he's just extremely different in his thinking. That rounds out the team much better.
Okay. Well, thanks a lot, Matt. This was really interesting talking to you. And I'm really... I'm sure I will stay tuned for seeing you going towards IPO and expanding further and, well, towards world domination.
That's the goal.
Yeah. So I hope our listeners enjoyed this conversation with Matt as much as we did. If you want to know more about scaling up, please tune in for other episodes in this series. If you have any feedback on this episode, contact the Tyto team on LinkedIn or comment on the video episode of this podcast on YouTube. And of course, you can also drop us an email at hello@tytopr.com. Thanks for listening and see you soon.